Liege area. I think normally you do a little bus tour that you visit companies where you see practical applications of all sorts of mechanical engineering. And due to health and safety considerations, that is not really possible this year. So I'm delighted to give you a little insight into the applications of friction stir welding, which is a new welding process. And I think that gives you a very good overview of what can be done with this process. I think in addition, because you are not familiar with the principle of the process, I should explain some technical aspects of the process as well. So I propose that I give you some 60, 70 minutes presentation. We have a discussion afterwards. And feel free to ask any questions in the chat box. Eve will have a look whether there's something coming up. But the idea is that we use the microphone then to do the discussion after the event. I will share my screen with you. What you can see is Alustair is a consultancy company that I have set up some 3 years ago, and I'm in the unique position to share information about a variety of different processes, mainly a solid phase welding processes. So this is, for example, friction stir welding and rotary friction welding and linear friction welding. And I teamed this up with all the former employees that I had, like TWI, Stirtec, Hufschmied, and then with some friends at Reiser and EugenTec. And I provide consultancy, and I sell machines, and I provide training courses for companies. So generally, I provide know-how, and this is based on my experience. I'm a welding engineer, so I took mechanical engineering, and then on top of that, a special 3 month course to become international welding engineer. And the idea is to have a lot of success by working with me. So typically you should get 10 times a return on investment. Not every project in research and development is successful. So if every 10th generates 10 times the return on investment, then that would be quite good. I think Yves Marchal has mentioned friction stir welding to you during his course, and the idea is that the process was invented at TWI, the Welding Institute in Cambridge, England. TWI is a large research organization with more than 500 employees on several sites all over the world, and they occasionally come up with new inventions. So, for example, a laser that you see in the James Bond movie Goldfinger, that was actually on a TWI site, and at that time, laser cutting was very unusual. So, in 1991, Wayne Thomas, a person from Wales, Wales in the eastern part of the United Kingdom, in the western part of the United Kingdom. He's an experienced friction welder and has looked at a lot of variety of different processes. And so he came up with an investigation of looking on the plasticized material that is between the two parts that can be friction welded by rotary friction welding and friction surfacing, for example. And based on that, he made a systematic invention. So it is not that just when someone used a blunt milling cutter and jammed that into his workpiece and decided, oh, this is a new process. No, he came up with some thoughts to come up with that idea. And then he had a good technician, Peter Temple-Smith, who demonstrated that technically. And by that, the curiosity was already generated, and he filed for a patent. But then a very important person came into play, that was Chris Dawes. And he teamed up with about 25 companies who funded some R&D work to get this project out of, or this process out of the laboratory and into industrial production. So it was developed, the process was developed in a group-sponsored project. So the industrial companies, they had to pay some certain participation fees. And they were non-competing companies, and some of them were the first users of friction stir welding, and some of them you can't beat. So they are the first to use the process and still are the market leaders in that area. The initial applications were shortly after, in 1995, so only 4 years after the invention, particularly for welding ship panels or helicopter platforms of oil platforms, and also in the rail industry for making railway rolling stock. The process is ideal for long length and particularly for high strength aluminium alloys. So the aerospace industry, and particularly the manufacturers of spacecraft or rockets, they found this process very interesting and decided to implement it in production. And these days, possibly the key application is in the area of heat exchangers for cooling power electronics and in the application of battery trays for making electrical vehicle, and particularly in China, where there is a quick growing market. Friction stir welding is particularly useful for aluminium alloys. For other alloys, I will tell you in a minute, it is more difficult because they have a higher melting point. And aluminium alloys are particularly used in the transport industry. So what you see here is a rail yard in Russia, and you see a lot of tank vessels transporting fluids. And one of the fluids to be transported is nitric acid, that is the rocket fuel that needs to be filled into the rockets that go into space. And one of the manufacturers, first of road tankers, then of rail tankers, and finally of aerospace tanks, is a company called CESPO. In our first video, we look only at three videos today, but the first video is in Russia, and I will show you while it is being played. So what you see is the principle of friction stir welding. I hope you can see the sound, because I see it's a little bit twitching now. Otherwise, we will come back in a minute. The idea is to use it in rail vehicles, and particularly to use it for rail vehicles and in road tankers, as you see here, rail vehicles like coal transporting and transporting of fluids. Here's a big friction stir welding machine that is just being implemented, and you see they use vacuum clamping to suck the sheets onto the backing bar. And the machine is operated very effectively by three operators who clamp the sheets very firmly. And here you see the rotating tool. This is the key process. You just have, similar to a milling cutter, a blunt tool which is profiled, and that is pressed with high force into the joint line and then traversed along the joint line to make a solid face weld. Solid face weld means it is below the melting point of the materials, and by that you get very low distortion and very high strength. These welds are stronger than conventional laser welds or MIG welds, and they are of very high and very repeatable quality. Here you see the little tool. It consists out of a little pin and a shoulder above that. And of course, the belt would be covered in a few days after the machine is fully commissioned. So this driving belt should not be as open as we can see it here. But it's a nice insight to see, I would say, maybe some 11 to 15 kilowatts of electrical energy being transferred through a gearbox and then a driving belt onto the spindle. A very good surface finish. So this is a very interesting application in Russia. But the first uses of friction stir welding were obviously not in Russia, but surprisingly in Norway and Sweden, in Scandinavia. And what we see here is not a Swedish a ship, but a ship in the United States. And you see on the left photograph, you see a large panel between the bows of a catamaran. And this aluminium panel, that is made by friction stir welding. So it's a prefabricated panel, and it is made from aluminium extrusions. They weld several extrusions side by side until they get a very large panel. In many cases, it's maybe, let's say, maximum 3.5 meters wide, so that can be transported on the roads, a transporter. But if it's transported by ship, then the size is just limited by the length of aluminium that you can extrude, and that is typically 16 meters. You see on the right picture, first of all, the panel has been installed here in the underbelly, they call it, of the ship, and also here on the side walls. And there are other ships which have even more friction stir welded panels. So this is really changing the way of ship manufacture. And particularly because you can lift the aluminium components after pre-manufacturing them. So you build several prefabricated modules, and then you assemble them in the shipyard, where time is, of course, precious, can assemble them very easily. In this right photo, you see not all welds are made by friction stir welding, so the sheet-to-sheet welding is still done by conventional MIG welding, and that is quite a good process. And so are the friction stir welded panels. They are also joined by MIG welding into the rest of the structure. Here the situation is a little bit different. In the spacecraft manufacture, you see a Delta rocket on the left. Large tanks are made from aluminium lithium alloys, and these alloys cannot be welded by conventional fusion welding processes. The only process that is more or less only process that is used is VPPA, that is variable polarity plasma arc welding. That is like an arc welding process with the light being emitted. And however, VPPA is not easy in rocket manufacture. And for the aluminium lithium alloys, it was not the right process. So they decided very early to invest into large machines. And you see two of these large machines here behind the tank. On the left-hand side, this is the friction stir welding machine. The tank is welded in a vertical position. On the right-hand side, you see someone already with a corona protection. So this is a very new and very recent photograph. And you see a three-dimensional, they call it friction stir welding robot, a three-dimensional friction stir welding machine to make the crew model to the next manned space missions to the moon. So some astronauts will soon fly to the moon in a friction stir welded crew compartment. The Japanese were the very first to use the process for rail cars, for railway rolling stock, so typical rail vehicles, typically mainly for passenger vehicles. And the Japanese do that mainly because of the visual appearance. So you see here a train that they have exported from Japan to England. And you see it has a very smooth sidewall. And that would be very difficult to achieve with conventional MIG welding processes only. So they use it mainly for visual appearance. However, I was involved in an accident investigation after the Ladbroke Grove accident. And there a steel train ran into an aluminium train, a conventionally welded aluminium train. And the conclusions was we need more crash-worthy aluminium trains. And what you see on the right-hand side, that is the answer. So friction stir welded panels are being joined by friction stir welding, and then they will be welded by MIG welding into the rail cars, for example, of the London Underground. SAPA, or what they are called now, is Hydro, because they have been taken over by some Norwegian friends. And they use a lot of friction stir welding for making heat sinks or heat absorbers, heat exchangers. So you see on the left-hand slide, left-hand photo, you see very fine lines. This part is made from three extrusions, because there's no aluminium extrusion press on their side, which would be able to do that in one go. So they extrude three smaller extrusions, and then they join them by friction stir welding. They do more than 1,000 meter friction stir welding per day. And I have just been seeing a press release by my friends Riftec. This is a job shop in the Hamburg region in Germany. Last week, they have welded 6.5 kilometers in 1 week. I'm not sure how many workdays they worked, but that is even a little bit more than 1,000 meters a day, I guess. The typical application is to have water-cooled heat exchangers, for example, for cooling electronics. And for these, you first machine maybe an extruded aluminium component so that there is an area where the water can flow through. And then you insert the little lid and you friction stir weld the lid. And then you machine that to a same surface finish as you see here on the right-hand side, so that the electronics can be glued or attached to this heat sink. On the right-hand side, this is a very unusual application. And you see it looks a little bit like the rockets of Lockheed Martin. And it has even here a big company named Lockheed Martin mentioned on it. So Lockheed Martin does not only do rockets, but they do also do environmentally friendly energy. And in Hawaii, they investigated a new concept of generating electricity by having heat exchangers where two different types of water of the ocean are used. The surface water, which is hot or warm, and very deep, I think 1,000 meter deep, take out some cold water. And by the heat difference between the different type of water, they generate electricity in the heat exchangers. I'm particularly proud about the automotive applications that happened in friction stir welding. And what you see on the left-hand side is the aluminium space frame of the Ford GT sports car. A space frame manufacture is very nice. And for example, the Audi A2 and the Audi A8, for example, they are space frame structures. However, the only problem is they are a little bit more expensive than the conventional high-volume produced Golf and Passat cars of the same group. So friction stir welding would be a way of reducing the manufacturing cost of these structures. And Ford did so by joining here two extrusions to a bent sheet in the center tunnel of the Ford GT car. And this center tunnel contains the fuel tank. So the fuel tank is here in a very safe area. The engine is in the back. And this is a very clever means of using that big space between the driver and the passenger for storing fuel. Another application is in Scandinavian wheels of Fundo and some other manufacturers. And they use two friction stir welds, one from this side and one from underneath here, to join the hub to the rim. So this is a very lightweight wheel, because here this is not aluminium, but it is air. And by that, they make for the Volvo X90 and for the Audi and so on, they make wheels in high volume production for the large SUV vehicles, where weight saving is critical. Weight saving in the wheels makes really sense, because these are not suspended by the suspension system. So having light wheels and light roofs, that is where you should target your first approach on reducing the weight of cars. the airspace or aircraft industry, we are very quick to take up the process. And one of the most interesting applications is the welding, friction stir welding of the Eclipse 500 business jet. This is a jet for, I think it was for six people, I think, plus two pilots, pilot and co-pilot. So six passengers, like a little air taxi. And the idea was to, instead of using riveting to make the aluminium parts, they will use friction stir welding. And they have quite a number. I didn't write down how many Eclipse 500 they produced. But the market was slow and the effort to make them was more expensive than they had hoped for. So by that, it wasn't a financial success, or to say it was a financial stalemate or disaster. And they decided not to go ahead with that route, but not for technical reasons. Technical reasons were also involved in flight software and de-icing software and all these sorts of things, navigation software. But the engines were problematic as well. So this was like a startup company trying to get into the business. And they were very successful indeed and got FAA approval, Federal Aviation Administration approval. A delightful story. I could tell you for hours and hours what happened there. Another interesting application is shown here underneath the beast of the American president. These are the toenails of the military Globemaster aircraft. And just these tiny little parts here between the ramp and the floor are the first friction stir welded airworthy parts, part that are being used in commercial production. I have sometimes people coming and say, oh, it's made from aluminium, and they do not really know the differences of the different aluminium alloys. And I'm not sure whether you have already gone through metallurgy, or if so, then it is a little reminder or a little repeat on what's going on. And if not, I really recommend to get used to the American type of classification. And you see, they classify the aluminium like 1000 series, 2000 series, 6000 series. I would say 6000 series is the most common alloy, particularly for aluminium extrusion. And maybe 5000 is the most common alloy for sheets. 5000 has an advantage that it is more seawater resistant, so that is good. However, both of these alloys, they are not of the highest strength. The highest strengths are typically here these 2000 series and 7000 series. In 2000 series, you will have a mixture between aluminium and copper, like an alloy of aluminium and copper. And in the 7000 series, you have an alloy of aluminium and zinc. And the only problem, you see the red boxes here, these alloys, they are very high strength, so by that you can make very lightweight structure, but they cannot be fusion welded. Some very special processes are necessary if you want to use fusion welding, for example, like VPPA welding or electron beam welding, very specialized processes. So friction stir welding can weld all these alloys and can weld even combination of these alloys, for example, joining aluminium extrusions to sheets, as we have seen in Russia, or joining extrusions to castings, as we see in the Chinese battery trays of these electrical vehicles. So dissimilar aluminium joining is a big advantage. And from my point of view, I have done some laser welding as well. It is much more simple than laser welding because you don't have all these problems with reflection and blowholes and whatever you get. So, and particularly when you do aluminium castings and there is some gas entrapped in the voids in these castings, and then you get into them by fusion welding, by laser welding, for example, then you get aluminium being expelled, like sputtering out. No friction stir welding below the melting point of the material. Ideal process for joining aluminium castings or aluminium castings to anything else like extrusions. I want to show you which other materials can be friction stir welded and want to start with steel. I have worked at Stirtec, a company that is specialized in friction stir welding of steel. But even they will admit that the wear on the tool is quite a challenge. So you see here, if you do friction stir welding of steel, the tool gets quite hot and it glows like a cherry red. And this results in the tool, some debris contaminating the welds, and the tool then deteriorating, and finally you will shear off the pin. So friction stir welding of steel is difficult. On the left-hand side, you see some samples of 12% chromium steel made at TWI and bent tested. You see it with the face intention, and then I think one of it's with the root intention, and one is just the parent material. And that was done very early, I think before the change of the century, so that was 1998 or 1999, and with a very great promise. But even so, there are only one or two industrial applications of friction stir welding in the world for welding steel. And this is one of them is shown on the top right. This is making hunting knives by friction stir processing. Friction stir processing means you just refine the microstructure. You make very fine grains inside the cutting edge of the part. You see two knife edges are made out of one part, one here, one on the right-hand side. But it's not a real welding process, it's just a friction stir processing, a microstructural change of the steel. I have worked in 1995 on using friction stir welding for titanium, because we believed, oh, it's very easy to weld titanium by rotary friction welding or linear friction welding, because titanium has a very low heat conductivity. So the heat stays really around that rotating tool. However, all the problems are different. The problem is that titanium reacts with everything. So with the oxygen, with the nitrogen, and any other gases that you have in the atmosphere. So you need to apply some gas shielding, and that is done by these two tubes shown here on the top. And you need to apply some gas shielding, and then it can be done very effectively. And it has been done at TWI to make a little demonstrator part for ESA, European Space Agency, a pressure vessel made from titanium. I personally see big potential in using friction stir welding for copper. And I have a very nice, had a very nice boss, Dave Niklas, who still was in contact with me on New Year's Day this year and is in a quite good mood. And he said, oh, now we want to weld 50 millimeter thick copper canisters. I said, oh, let us do it step by step and start maybe with the thinner material first. But you see, we succeeded finally. And we and the SKB, this is the authority that encapsulates nuclear fuel, so waste, nuclear waste from atomic power plants in Sweden. And they want to put that into an old, similar to salt mines. They are old underground mines, no, new underground mines. And they want to store the radioactive waste down there. And to make sure that if water comes in or potentially even some people walk in, they would not be contaminated. They want to encapsulate that into a very corrosion resistant material. The Americans decided to go for stainless steel, and the Swedish people decided to go for copper. So 50 millimeter thick copper canisters with a diameter of, let's say, 980 millimeter or 1 meter. Approximately 1 meter in diameter and 5 meter long. Two knits need to be welded side by side. Quite a challenging application, but very successful application. Electron beam welding would be an alternative, but it works with more difficulties than the friction stir welding process. So why not use friction stir welding only? On the right-hand side, you see a commercial application in Japan. This is when the first flat screen TVs came up. Large sputter targets, where water-cooled sputter targets needed to be made to make these large panels. And now everybody can buy them very cheaply because friction stir welding is such a good process for making the sputter targets. A very unusual application is friction stir welding of magnesium. What you see here is a Japanese roof box on a tiny little Japanese car. I admire the Japanese for happy with what they have. They don't need to represent their status by large vehicles. They need small cars that they can park in front of their small houses. And small cars, of course, have a problem that you can't store much luggage in them. So why not put it in the roof, not for transporting skis, but also maybe to put a little suitcase in there, for example. And you see here on the left-hand side, very easily visible, the friction stir welds. That was a very clever application of friction stir welding to magnesium. And in this case, it's even a special magnesium alloy. I think it contains a lot of calcium that cannot burn. So if people say, oh, there's a risk of magnesium burning, yes, it is, but it's not a big problem. Even the Mercedes SL had magnesium in the car doors, and I don't know anyone who has died from burning car doors in Mercedes SL cars. Friction stir welding can also be applied to plastics. What we see here is friction stir spot welding. So these guys do not traverse, they just plunge the tool in. And the nice thing is they can put a little camera in the face of the plastic material. It's a perspex or a transparent type of polycarbonate. And they can see how the tool rotates and how it generates the thermomechanically affected zone. And that is a very nice work of you see here at the bottom, you see the names mentioned who did the work. Some Italian guys doing really a great work there. Wayne Thomas, the inventor of friction stir welding, had come up with two variants of the process where he wants to vibrate a blade, like a knife blade, between, like a razor blade, between the parts and moves them up and down or maybe diagonally. And then there's an Italian guy again who moves it forward and backward. So this is like a little jigsaw, and that works very well for plastics indeed. I don't think that I have taken a photograph of the device, no, I haven't. I personally worked at a company called StirTech as the CSO, Chief Sales Officer, and in StirTech we specialized in welding dissimilar materials. What you see here is the aluminium welded to copper and copper welded to steel. And we did a little trick. The trick is the tool does not traverse in the joint line anymore. It is a little bit offset. So what you see here is not on this part, but on similar parts, an investigation, an offset of, let's say, maybe from 1.4 millimeter up to 3 millimeter. So that moving the tool pin just into the aluminium and only scratching with the rotating tool the copper alloy to disrupt the oxides on the copper. So you see, oh, it needs to be determined experimentally what is the best way of doing so. And there's another little secret that I want to share with you. StirTech uses material which is a little bit thicker on the soft side. So let's say maybe 0.1 or 0.2 millimeter thicker than the copper alloy. And by that, we have a lubricant, a layer of plasticized aluminium on top of the copper. And by that, we significantly reduce the wear, especially when welding a slightly thicker copper to a steel. That is a very clever method of doing that. I decided, oh, your first question, if we were live, you would ask, yeah, and how does the tool look? And the very first tool in this group-sponsored project to get the process from laboratory curiosity into the commercial manufacturer was a cylindrical tool, just like a metrical bolt. And that tool has to have a rounded bottom then near the root. And you see, they came up with the idea of tilting this tool. This tool moves from the left to the right. So this is unwelded material and this is welded material. And what you see here is this is the onion ring structure. So if I take a section through the material here, I see similar to the onion rings of an onion that I cut through, I see some spherical microstructures there, which are very typical for friction stir welding. To be honest, they are not absolutely necessary. So there are even some more sophisticated tools now which do not generate the microstructure. And there are some material combinations where you can't see it. So I wouldn't say it is necessary, but it is certainly good. There are some people claiming this was a negative effect, but I'm not sure what they are talking about. Maybe they want to explain it could be even improved by having a different type of tools, but there is certainly nothing wrong with seeing these onion rings. And the idea is that you use the thread in a way that the bolt would be unbolted or loose by rotating it in this direction. So this machine can be only rotated in clockwise direction looking from above. And so they use a left-handed thread. This is something which you cannot buy in the supermarket. This is something you need to go to a specialized screw seller. And or you have to machine it yourself, and they often machined it themselves. So this is a left-handed thread that pumps material downwards. So you know how these drills work, where you can put lampposts into the floor. And the idea is that we want to do something similar, but the other way around. We don't want to move the material upwards. We want to pump it downwards. So this is like using these drills the wrong way around. We press the material into the root area, because if we don't get this downward pressure, then we get an internal void, a tunnel defect. So here you see this classical 5651 tool being investigated by some American investigators, and they compared with all sorts of tri-fluid tools, scrolled shoulders, small Viper tools, Viper TM and so on. Personally, I think a very good compromise tool, and this is not the tool for everything, but this is a very good tool, has just been published by TWI here shown on the right-hand side. And this pushes the material downwards, and it helps to drag the material from the front of the material to the back. And what you see is we have a spiral-shaped shoulder. The shoulder drags the material inwards. So by that, we do not need to tilt the tool by these 2.5 degrees anymore. So on the previous slide, you see here, material is trapped underneath and then compressed by this shoulder. And this works like a snowplow, pushing material downwards. And here the material is being dragged inwards and then by the profile on the pin moved downwards. I'm actually the salesman of a company in the Munich area, Hufschmied. And Hufschmied, they make typically very nice cutting mills, for example, for machining composite materials, but they make also the very best friction stir welding tools, and you see a big variety. These are robotic tools which have a stationary shoulder. The shoulder does not rotate, and then they have flats on the tools. Whatever you want, we can get it to you and can sell these tools. And these days, most people in production, they don't make their own tools anymore. They get a commercial tool supplier to supply them with the tool. What are the functions of the tool? You see some metallurgical description of the different regions. So there is here a nugget that is the plasticized material that was soft but not molten. It is more soft like Gouda cheese or maybe like brie, but it is not like milk. It is not fluid. It is, I want to say semi-solid, but it is actually in the solid phase. It is below the melting point of the materials, of the workpiece materials. And then surrounding that, you have the thermomechanically affected zone. And then wider outward is the heat affected zone. And surprise, surprise, That is the weakest part of a friction stir weld. Here, you have the refined microstructure. The weld is very strong, but the heat affected zone, this is where heat treated alloys like 6082T6 means it is treated by heat treatment, participation hardening. By heat treating, you increase the strength of the alloy, but when you weld it, like fusion welding, you get only 60% of the strength of the material. And in friction stir welding, it's at least 83, 85, or 90% of the material. The problem if you don't have a tool that pumps material downwards, and this is the thread is moved in a way that it pumps material downwards, that you would get a little tunnel defect or an internal void, an area that is not being consolidated. And this happens, for example, if the downward pressure is too low or if the tool position is too high, if the tool rotates in the wrong direction, or if there is a gap between the work pieces. I recommend that you look into ISO 25239, and you can find that on the Alloister website. I have the first part free available for download. You can download part one for free, and the rest you have to purchase from the conventional standard organization. Or if you are a student, I really recommend that you download some of the important standards that you will need in your later life. Maybe you can do that in the university library, or maybe you can do it online these days in Munich University. For example, people have free access, students have free access to standards. I would recommend to take some copies, because later in life you will be happy that Stefan has told you. What you should avoid is any gaps between the work pieces, or any chamfers or radii, or if there is a casting, it should not be round, because otherwise you get even a surface breaking void, and this is not acceptable according to the standard. However, in some cases this can be quite useful, and I want to show you now the second video. And the second video is a process that we call friction stir channeling, or subsurfacing machining core flow. The idea is we rotate the tool in the wrong direction on purpose to make sure that we generate this void or this tunnel defect, and we want to run water through it. So what we see here is the probe or the pin, and then a tool with a non-rotating shoulder, a static shoulder, and you saw the meander that we have just generated on the previous trial. So what we do now is we rotate the tool the wrong way around, and we pump material upwards, and this material comes out through a little hole, there's an escape hole, and we leave a channel inside the aluminium component. This channel is used to pump water through at the time later, and by that we can cool, for example, electronic components. The profile of the pin is even more important here. And by the way, this is a patented process, so if you want to apply this process, friction stir welding is not patented anymore. The patent is was only a 20 years duration, but this one is still valid. So you need to negotiate a deal with TWI, the Welding Institute, who invented that core flow process. And then you can attach electronics either from this side or from the other side, or from both sides, to the aluminium heat sink, or to the cooling device, and you can pump water through it. And there are a variety of different applications, things about high voltage applications in automotive cars, electrical vehicles, but also in a space or in aircraft, for example, in the engines of aircraft, and in telecommunication, you name it, it will be there. So far we have mainly in the video, maybe you have observed it quickly, there was also some lap welding in the very first video, but the process has so far been mainly used for butt welding. Butt welding means sheet to sheet, side by side. But Now I want to use it for overlap welding, similar to when you have a riveted structure, you put one part on top of the other and then you connect them by bolts or rivets. And here we want to weld parts that are overlapping each other. So you see the challenge is then that we pump too much material downwards and we lift up the joint line here. And if we do a tensile test, pulling here and pulling here, then you see only this tiny little region will transfer the load. So a lot of people do not fully understand that the tool that they have developed for butt welding is not the best tool for lap welding. And to address that, I have teamed up with a number of companies. Three of them are consultancy companies in England, and more universities are signing up to this project. And industrial companies are coming soon. This is just in the beta phase. It has been launched 1 or 2 weeks ago. And I can offer to you, you can, as a student of Liège University, you can join this project ICAMSTIR free of charge. ICAMSTIR, this is using artificial intelligence in computer-aided manufacturing of friction stir welding. So we want to develop a little tool that learns itself how should the tool be designed and which parameters should be used. For the tool design, we want to apply CFD, that is computational fluid dynamics. And you see here, this is like finite element modeling. We want to model how this material is being pumped downwards and optimize the shape of the tool to get the very best tool design to avoid this hooking and thinning effect while stirring very effectively all the oxides between these materials to make sure that we have no remnant joint lines. So what you see here is here he has his hooking, here he has his thinning, and here he has his remnant joint line. These are some very good guys in Lortec in Spain. So these guys know what they do, and they have come up with a solution. So this is a bad weld that they show on purpose to show the good welds in this publication then later on. And the idea that they have come up with is the idea shown here in the bottom. They have threads that are moving material downwards and threads that move material upwards. And behind there is a third one, which don't move it at all. So left-handed, right-handed, and neutral threads on one pin. I have a slightly different approach, and I want to use a pentagonal shape or maybe some optimization of a sort of pin that disrupts the oxide layer. Or corona shape, corona is the word these days, a coronated or prong shape, which disrupts the oxides. So we have three different concepts which have been published already in the public domain. And we want to investigate those by the means of artificial intelligence and computer-aided manufacturing for friction stir welding. I'm a mechanical engineer and I'm very much focused on developing machines and clamping systems that are suitable for friction stir welding. And on the left-hand side, you see a big panel welding machine. So the welds is being done underneath that beam, which is shown here on the right-hand side. But here I made more clear what it is all about. You have an extrusion and you join one extrusion to another extrusion. And you do that by friction stir welding. At that time, they did it with a meter a minute welding speed. And these days, maybe you use 2.3, 2.5 meters, and in some application, up to 4 or even more than that. So it depends on the thickness or the pin length that you have. The welding thick parts is more time consuming, and thin parts can be done with 10 meters a minute if you have the right machine and the right clamping fixtures. And then they shift the whole panel a little bit further left and they make the next extrusion joint to it, shift left, make the next extrusion to it. So one after one, they do extrusion to extrusion. Here you can see it maybe more clearly. This is the friction stir welding spindle at the bottom. And then they clamp down these heavy clamps because you see they have a little bit of distortion. And this is absolutely essential in friction stir welding. You need to close that gap. The gap should not be larger than 10% of the sheet thickness. And then you need to adjust the tool in the right height. In 1995, you used little rollers to make sure that it doesn't plunge too deep. Then they started in 1999 measuring the forces, which is still the preferred way of doing it, because if you have a workpiece that is not absolutely flat, then this force-controlled system that runs on top of the surface of the material, similar to a ship that swims on top of the water. And you will see this yellow lever later on as well. You see now we have a compliant system. To compliant means it's like a spring. It's a hydraulic spring that presses the sheets onto the backing bar. And the tool in this case is CNC controlled using position control and or using force control. Yeah, the trick is really, if you know how to do friction stir welding, and particularly if you have poor tolerances on your workpieces, then force control is the way to go. However, if you're very clever, then you do not only rely on force control, but you have also some limits that you, by theory, say, oh, can't be passed. And so there are some combinations, a clever combination of position and force control, and you don't talk about that. That means proprietary is top secret computer control mechanisms, how to control the plunge depth of your part. This is done now in commercial production. And first of all, I want to show you two R&D machines based at TWI, the Welding Institute. And these are two gantry machines. A very heavy duty machine that can weld with 150 kilonewton of downward force, that is 15 metric tons, 15,000 kilograms downward force pressing downwards. And it has two heads, one from the top, one from the bottom. So you can, if you have a different table here, you can weld parts from both sides simultaneously. And it has 11 axes to be moved around. So this spindle axis can be moved by three axes. It's like a robot, a very clever device. I think one of the largest R&D machines worldwide. Then my boss said, oh, if they get one, if that's in Sheffield, that was a new site that was being generated, we want to have one in Cambridge as well. So I was the project leader of the Eurostir project. That was like a Eureka project, a European project. And by that, we invested into this, at the time, it was quite expensive machine, a gantry machine, which has parameter envelope of 5 by 7 meters. And at that time was new, could weld non-linear welds in the plane. So in flat components, it could weld non-linear parts. Machines became then more complicated. This is three-dimensional welding. Now you saw this Eclipse aircraft, and this is the side panel. There are the little windows on another one. You see it better. The windows in these aluminium sheets of that business jet. Very complicated clamping, and you see these people look a bit puzzled. Clamping was more complicated than they had investigated. And then they have a clever mechanism, at least one or two cameras, and then someone who knows the business, that is the most important person, is one has to take the responsibility. I think he is helping as well, showing what to do. So a team is always good if you want to be successful. And I have to say, technically, they were very successful. That is really to be admired. I showed you the big 5 by 7 meters machine. So I had a friend then, Torben Lorentzen at Danstør in Denmark. And he said, oh, I can't invest in the wide gantry. I have to go through 3 meters only instead of 5. I said, if you want to have the largest machine, you need to make it 15 meter long. And he came up, oh, Stefan, that's a clever idea. I haven't thought about that. So he had not enough money to pay for these expensive bearings, but at least he made the steel structures long enough. Then whenever he could get a 15 meter long part, he could just have invested in a little bit in a project, invested in a little bit more bearings. And then he would have had the largest machine in Europe with 3 by 15 meter long, which is more or less the maximum length of extrusion. Again, this was not a true financial success, and he got a lot of competition, particularly by the aluminium extruders, who didn't like the idea of someone else adding value to their extrusions. So they sold the extrusions, and you need to get them extruded very accurately. They sold them at a higher price than they got it themselves in their own factories. And by that, the aluminium extruders always were one step ahead of Torben. I'm really sorry for him. But this machine has been finally sold to a shipyard in Holland called Bayyards, and it is used now in day-to-day production. And if you see the photographs of what they do at Bayyards, this is delightful. They make mainly helicopter platforms and then panels for shipbuilding. Simple flat parts, but with accuracy and for making that for bridges and so on. So whenever you go to Holland to Bayyards, please send them my regards. I admire what they do. Then I teamed up with my Austrian friends at Störtec, and we decided, we want to focus on a different market. Here, there's a lot of steel involved in the long machines, and my friends, Thomas Meinberger and Gunter Fiegner, they have done large machines before, and they did not want to get involved in all this heavy stuff, but they want to get involved with clever algorithms for welding aluminium castings and steel components. So we came up with a very smooth system, what we call Störtec machines, which looks like a conventional milling machine and has some parts like the machine bed and so on, is out of a high volume production, a very rigid machine, milling machine, CNC milling machine, but it has a very clever tool spindle and a very clever algorithm. So that would be hours and hours I could talk about the purpose or the advantages of this concept for sizes up to, let's say, maybe 2.3 meters by 1.8 meters. That is the largest machine that they have. The typical size of a battery tray. So battery trays is the big business. However, then there are some people who say, robotic friction stir welding is what you have to go for. And I share their optimism, but I had said to one customer, I said, one of our machines is faster than two robots, and he bought one of our machines instead of the two robots. Fine, I got the project. So I'm still proud about that. But I admire that there are some things that you cannot do with this type of concept. And this will be using articulated robot or possibly some parallel kinematics robot, which I'll show later. But you see, there's a lot of know-how involved here. You need clever know-how. And the idea is you do not rotate the shoulder anymore. So this robot is flimsy and cannot react to very high forces. So by that, it is necessary to optimize the idea. And I want to show you now stationary shoulder friction stir welding in edges. So this would be for those of you who are in the aerospace industry, the ways of attaching stringers and spars to skins. And close by you have Sonaka and Sapka, who are both very much interested in that type of welding process. The shoulder is just like a ski or a shoe, and it does not rotate, and it is in that corner of the fillet joint, and you see the rotating pin that plasticizes the aluminium material. And then you traverse the tool along the joint line, a very clever way of doing. And you can do that with a conventional articulated arm robot, so that is easily done in commercial production. So if you want to know more, please contact me. I will tell you. I want to come up only with one variant here in this presentation today. This is friction stir spot welding. And you see, we do not traverse the tool anymore. We just plunge in and out. And again, we have this challenge. And this is a bad weld, actually. And this is a little bit better weld. There you see the hooking is not as extreme. But here you see only a small area being joined. You see, a lot of work is necessary. A lot of work is being done. So StirTech, for example, offers either stationary machine where the workpieces is transported, or robotic applications for making sheet-to-sheet overlap welds. Actually, the Japanese are leading this field. They implemented that very early for the Mazda RX-8. And my Bavarian friend said, oh, this will never happen in Bavarian cars. So for visual reasons, we would not accept in Bavarian cars this type of appearance. But the Japanese know themselves, and they come up with an improvement, which I will show you in a minute. Here we see it in American car applications. This is a non-disclosed car, where we don't know which car it was, but it was a prototype for an American vehicle. And very successful by Stirling, friction Stirling. The Japanese use it for the roofs of their rail vehicles. This is a stainless steel laser welded car body, and it has an aluminium friction stir welded roof on top. And this is the variant that I want to mention, Kawasaki. You see here, this is the same guys who make the motorcycles, but this is Kawasaki Heavy Engineering. And they make very neat ways of doing refill friction stir spot welding machines, not only used in Japan, but also United Kingdom, USA, and so on. And again, here you see the first aerospace applications. This is the way how to manufacture strings and spars and stringers and stuff. Two skins of, I would say, maybe initially maybe the doors of aircraft, but in future the complete aircraft will be, instead of riveted, it will be friction stir spot welded, and in this case refill friction stir spot welded for the aesthetical appearance and to overcome these problems with hooking and thinning and small areas and stuff like that. Very simple application here by my two friends in United Kingdom, in England, R&S and Otto Juncker, very German name, by the way. They make machines, and depending on your color choice, you get it either from R&S or Otto Juncker. They came up at a very early, a similar time, to join log to log or billet to billet for extrusion presses. Can tell you more if you need to know. What are the benefits of friction stir welding? It's a solid phase welding process. You see here all the advantages: no melting, low distortion, no fume, no sputter, and so on. And it can work in all positions, non-linear, non-planar, three-dimensional, and very simple machine tools. Everybody who can operate a milling machine can also operate a friction stir welding machine, and it can be done fully automated and by robots. However, I want to be honest, there are some limitations. It is a little bit slower than laser welding, for example. Machines are expensive because they are very rigid, similar in investment cost like a milling machine. The workpieces must need well clamped, and in automotive that is sometimes difficult. Think about a nice car, you can't support that from all sides underneath to do a friction stir welding. You need a backing bar unless you have a tool coming from both sides or use a bobbin tool. That is a tool with two shoulders and a pin in between. You have a keyhole at the end of the weld. And yeah, one of the problems is if you know how to do it, you don't talk about it. I'm the exception. And even I keep some secrets. You don't really know which rotation speed, which is the tool design, and so on. So a lot of open questions. And this is where you are, as the next generation of R&D researchers and users, are challenged to come up with your own ideas how to overcome problems like tool wear and so on. I guess you would ask me, what is the thinnest material that you can weld? 1.2 millimeter thick, for example, is typical. What is the thickest? 75 millimeter for military tanks, not a big problem. And even here, 75 millimeter in one pass is possible. and 100 millimeter, for example, if you weld from both sides at the same time. So thickness is not really a problem. I haven't seen much thicker aluminium parts being welded or joined ever. So 100 millimeter, I think, is more or less that what the industry needs as a maximum. For example, if you have ballistic impact in military tanks, for example, this is a friction spur weld that has been tested by putting an artillery shell against it. Here you see I have been involved in this improvement of welded aluminium trains. And one of them, this is a Pendolino train, which has partially friction stir welded side panels, derailed in Cumbria in England. And I'm very sorry, one person died, but and 30 were seriously injured. But in comparison to the severeness of this accident, the accident investigator said the crashworthiness of the structures was indeed very good. So they used different words, but they said that they stayed well intact, and they were, I think, surprised how well these car bodies withstood the high forces involved in this accident. I want to show you one accident here, a fire. There was someone smoking a cigarette on the balcony of a cruise ship, and I think someone had his swimwear being drying on a plastic chair. The cigarette fell onto the swimwear. This is a reconstruction afterwards. They tried to simulate what happened. Fell onto the swimsuit of that lady, and the plastic chair started burning, and the plastic wall between the balcony started burning. Yeah, and then you see aluminium melts, but please understand for now and forever, aluminium does not burn. So this is not burnt aluminium, this is just molten aluminium. The aluminium melted and dropped down, it didn't burn. So some people say, oh, maybe our military aircraft, military ships should not be made from aluminium, whatever they want. I personally, I'm a big friend of aluminium ships, and I have worked on a lot of ships in the Navy, and I know what I'm talking about, I believe. Okay, friction stir processing, that is one variant where you just consolidate voids in castings, for example, maybe with a parallel kinematics robot, or voids in aluminium pistons. And this is indeed what is being done. It can also be used for reprocessing castings. Here, Boeing filed a patent on refining some microstructure in a cast area. But finally, they decide to replace this riveted structure in an intrusion beam in a freight aircraft. They replaced that by friction stir welded parts. They did not go for the FSP, friction stir processing route, but they used friction stir welding. And this was the first structural part in a civilian aircraft. We are coming up to the time limit that I have given myself, and the idea is to come up with some conclusions. Aluminium extrusions and heat exchangers are the typical applications of friction stir welding, particularly for the shipbuilding and railway rolling stock industry, for aerospace, automotive, and these days even done by commercial contractors like job shops that use the process. It is suitable for all sorts of material, you know, particularly for aluminium, for dissimilar material combinations, and occasionally used for copper and steel. We have obtained approval by all the ship welding classification societies and by the German railway authorities and the TUV, for example. The Federal Aviation Authority in administration in America has approved it for civilian aircraft. And what you need now, when you start your career, you need to promote the type of products and services that would be promoting friction stir welding machines, promoting friction stir welding tool, and sharing friction stir welding know-how by consultancy and training. Or if you intend to go into a university and want to do your PhDs, then I would have a lot of ideas what you should investigate. And that would be, for example, process variants or difficult to join material combinations. And this is free of charge for any students, investigate artificial intelligence in computer-aided manufacture with the iCAMSTER project. This more or less concludes my presentation, and I want to hand over to the chairman now to do the discussions.
Okay. Thank you very, very much, Stefan. It was a very interesting presentation. We can now ask you some questions. If someone has a question for Stefan, please proceed.
I think the easiest would be if you ask, switch on your microphone and ask any questions if you have. Yaron, I see you raise your hand. Fine to ask you.
Yes, sir. For the AI CAM project, which aspects are you interested in? And so, for example, are you interested in the programming or the mechanical aspects, or the mechanical studies and parametric studies?
I am personally a Wikipedia author, and I have written about 2,000 articles on Wikipedia, not on welding, but on railway applications and stuff. And so I want to generate a cloud or a Wikipedia-style knowledge base where people can, for example, store data on suitable parameters that they investigated successfully. And then they can do that, the researchers can do that free of charge. And everybody in the world can read it free of charge. But the vision that I have is that a machine, if you have a new application of, let's say, maybe 10 millimeter thick 2000 series aluminium alloys, and you don't really know what parameters should I use, then this system will give you some guidelines. Try these and these parameters and this tool design. And then you will do your first experiments and upload a photograph of the results into that system. If you are a university, you can upload the photography of charge. If you are a company, you need obviously to pay a little fee. And then either the researchers and finally, of course, the artificial intelligence system, the computerized system, will look at the photograph and say, oh, you're much too hot, or you're much too cold, or you need to go faster, you need to go slower. So the system then will recommend automatically what should be changed and will give the operator a hint, oh, you should weld faster, or you should weld slower. And maybe at one stage it would do that even while the machine is running, and the operator says, oh yes, up to 10% faster and 10% slower is accepted. And then the system will automatically optimize the parameters in certain boundaries.
Perfect. Thank you for the insight. But to understand it quite well, it recommends the parameters of, let's say, feeding rates or whatever, but it does not recommend the parametric design of the tool.
Yeah, and this is an additional thing. If you have a new application, you don't really know how to design the tool. And this is what we want to use, the computerized fluid dynamics. We want to use FEM models, not only looking from the top onto the sheet, how the heat is being distributed, but also to look at the material flow around the tool. And we want to optimize the tool design by initially by CFD, but then of course by experimental validation. And that could be to have tools that weld faster, have tools that get stronger welds, to have tools that have a wider tolerance envelope. I do not think that we will have at the end one tool which is the very best optimized tool for everything. No, there will be a variety of 5 to 10 tool concepts that have certain advantages and limitations.
A great vision indeed. Thank you.
Any other question for Stefan?
Yes, Yves.
Well, I have also a question regarding friction stir welding. How does it behave on a corrosion point of view?
This is a very good question. So I have a friend in America whom I visited and proposed friction stir welding to him. And he said, oh, Stefan, it's very nice that you can make these dissimilar joints in different materials. However, we do not want to have dissimilar material joints in American SUVs, sport utility vehicles. So the Americans, they will in future, because they have a lot of salt in winter on their roads, and apparently three states, and Michigan is one of them, and Detroit, where all the cars are made, is the center of the salty states, they will not go for friction stir welded dissimilar material combinations. However, if you use precautions that are typical in dissimilar material joints, for example, if you have a ship and you have a steel hull and you want to have an aluminium superstructure, then these days you insulate the materials, maybe with some tar or some plastic, and then you bolt the parts together and you keep them electrically insulated. But I think, and I'm pretty sure about that, you can also weld them and you can have dissimilar materials welded. And this is done, for example, in radiators, no problem. However, you need to come up with corrosion protection mechanisms and then maybe coat your steel, for example, or make sure that the electrical discrepancy between the parts is not too big. So you have the conventional considerations regarding corrosion, but there is nothing special in friction stir. So if anything, then it is better than other combinations, unless you have a buffer layer in between parts. So I do not know of any friction stir specific concerns regarding friction stir welding, but in the case of dissimilar material combinations, it still needs to be considered. And there are some exceptional things like a grain growth of this refined microstructure, and then this grain growth causes then again some problems. So if you know what you are doing, you will get no problems, but you need to know very well.
Okay, thank you, Stefan. In fact, I was thinking about the welding of similar materials, but as you explained us very well, you have different regions, heat affected zone, thermomechanically affected zone, and they may have some different electrochemical potential. And I think that I've already seen somewhere in Birmingham, I think, people that conducted some investigations to avoid, to characterize and to avoid corrosion between the different zones of frictions the world.
Yes, indeed, that is required. So you need to know what you are doing, and you need to optimize your, I would say mainly the treatment of these parts, that they would be coated and kept free of water. So I know for sure if you have an aircraft and you just rivet these bars, you friction stir spot weld these bars to the skins and water comes in between, and then this is not a good idea. It's the conventional crevice corrosion that you have in any riveted components. So what you do on riveted, you put in some mastics or some composite or some glue in between the parts, and that is what we do in friction stir welding as well. So you need to keep water away from the critical area.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions from anyone else? I see Daniel Esteban has a question for you, Stefan.
Yes,
go ahead.
Good afternoon, thank you. I would like to make two questions. The first one, it is how expensive and how intense would be the transformation for a shipyard, for example, to change for a normal welding process to a steel welding, friction steel welding process. And the second question is, if all the evaluation methods that we have for electric arc welding apply as well for the friction steel welding.
Could you repeat the second question, please?
Yes, it is, if all the methods that we use to evaluate the quality of electric arc welding is also useful for this kind of welding.
Okay, I come to your first question first. I think in the automotive industry, it's more easy to say, so this type of CNC milling machine, which is like a converted milling machine, these sell in the region of, let's say, 300 to 500,000 euro. And so you would just need to invest in something which has the similar price to a milling machine. In the case of rail vehicles, we see also that these guys who make these side panels, they need to machine then windows and doors and little holes where they attach things to it, and they do that on large milling machines. So if they have a large milling machine, then maybe they can convert that. And for a railway rolling stock manufacturer, the investment is not that big because they have already suitable or machines that can be changed, or at least they can use their friction stir welding machine then also as a milling machine. So for them, it is attractive as well. Yeah, but for a shipbuilding company, they do typically, some of them start now doing investing in big machines as well. But there are only, I think, two or three shipyards in the world who have done the investment in building their own panel welding machine. And the others, they decide they keep the level of know-how that they need small, so they just purchase friction stir welded panels and then they weld them by MIG welding into their ships. And a big machine like that would be suitable for MIG weld for making ship panels, let's say 5 by 7 meters, that is typically above 1 million euro investment just for a big gantry machine. I haven't seen many gantry machines below that. At the moment, there are two second-hand machines available worldwide, one of them in Scotland, one in them in California. And in the case of California, I know this is at, let me say, 40% of a million. So you can get that at $380,000. That would be a 5-meter machine if you wanted to start tomorrow as a shipyard. And you can buy that through me. I have all the deals. And coming back to the question on the quality assurance, the most important things are two. First of all, parameter monitoring. So you need a clever way of checking your rotation speed, the welding speed, checking is your tool pin still there, checking the forces that are involved. For example, if you shear off your tool pin, then suddenly the traversing force is reduced and you know, oh, I sheared off my pin. So parameter monitoring, most important. Second important, if you know what you are doing, visual inspection is very important as well. So you just look at the parts. If you are a shipbuilding company and making these large panels, then you take samples at the start and the stop area. I haven't said the start and stop, these are not fully welded. So you need to cut off the start and stop region. And you take these cut off sections and investigate those. And then if you're an aerospace or a rocket manufacturer, then you use things like phased array ultrasonic inspection. Some people use X-ray, but I don't think that they see a lot in X-rays, but phased array ultrasonics is very good. And it is being done in aerospace applications. But for automotive, for example, this would be over the top. There you just go by statistical control, maybe taking metallurgical sections to show whether the process is still in general is still right. And then take some random samples where you do bend tests, for example. So you destroy maybe one part per shift or whatever in the morning to see whether the machine is still okay or the process is still okay. And you need to define that with this ISO standard 25. 23 to 225, you clarify that with the relevant ESO standard that I just mentioned. 25239.
Sorry. Thank you so much. I will certainly consider the second-hand option if creating a ship.
Very good.
Does anyone else have an additional question? No other question. So I want to thank you very much, Stefan. It was very kind of you to give us this talk. That was very interesting. Thank you again for this.
Yeah, I want to thank you for organizing it, and particularly I want to thank everybody who listened to it. I think you made good use of the restrictions that we have at the moment, and by that I think we need to adopt the ways how we learn and how we do business, and that could be even leading in some things to methods that we will even use if the situation changes. So stay optimistic. I think we are learning to cope with low-risk approaches in exchanging information.
Okay. Thank you very much. And for the students, I have just to add that we have another webinar starting in 1 hour. And so see you in 1 hour. And thank you again, Stefan. Goodbye.
Have a good time. Bye-bye.